I oversee all of special ed and all matters of student welfare. So what you do day in and day out certainly falls under that umbrella. And I, again, thank you for your care of our students. We spend a lot of time in our trainings about what we're going to do with students from 7:45 to 3:30 every day. And then we put them on a bus. We wave goodbye, and you take over. And I just, again, we have to, this was a reminder to us that we say, the time from when we put them on the bus to when they get home is just as important. And so again, thank you for your attention to this training today. The training is done by Northwestern Illinois Association, lovingly called NIA. And Sherry White is from NIA, and she has done a number of trainings for us in the past, and we really appreciate her personal touch and her experience, and she'll tell you a little bit about herself. And then Wendy Bono, maybe some of you have met Wendy. Wendy is one of our student service coordinators, and she works with our specialized programs. So many of you, she does all of our outplacements as well, coordinates all of our outplacements. So many of you drive our buses all over the suburbs to some of our outplacements. And so Wendy's the gal that you may have been, or Jason has been working closely with in regards to students. So without further ado, I just want to tell you a couple things. First of all, make sure that you fill up. There is coffee and breakfast, and that's for you. It's a little thank you. Secondly, down the hallway to your left are the bathrooms. So, you know, just housekeeping. There you go. And this will go to 11 o'clock, but we do know that more are coming, and some of you have routes in between. So hopefully you'll get in both of it. So without further ado, Sherry, thank you. So good morning. Thank you so much for being here. I hate to ride a bus, but I do ride a bus. Like, I get sick being on that bus, but I do appreciate you guys welcoming me onto your routes. I've seen quite a few of them, provided some background information about behaviors and students and how to work with difficult issues and longer bus rides. But if you have any questions, you can always ask Jason. He gets a hold of me, and then I provide what support that I can. So one of the things that I have been doing is going over with some of the drivers and attendants about safety vests and harnesses. So I just wanted to review some of that with you guys. We call this piece that the student wears the safety vest, and the piece that's on your seat is the harness. So most of the time the staff at school puts the safety vest on the students. It is meant to fit snugly, just like a car seat. You should be able to get your fingers in between the straps and the students. But it should be secure enough that they're not able to pull it over their shoulders and wiggle out up or down, which is what we usually see. We also want to make sure that when we're hooking them in, that they're tight into the harness too. So one of the things that I had shown is that when you hook in the bottom straps, make sure that those are tight, and you may need to adjust, just like when you put a wheelchair on a bus. You have to adjust those straps every single time. You may need to adjust this every single time. And a lot of times we see that they'll say, well, it's tightened down as much as it can be. Well, there's a little bit more room that you can do for a lot of these, especially for these straps up here. What I was showing is that, yes, this is as tight as it can go. We can't get anything more out of there, but if you open it up, I always take out that first slide. You can pull this even farther down back room so it's secure. But then these are much tighter. So you want to make sure that the biggest, the most important piece is that their hips are secure against the seat.
I'm kid size.
If you are kid size. So no, forwards. There you go. So once we get Christine into the bus, and it's not adjusted for her.
She's grabbing her arms.
Oh.
Good catch.
There we go. Christy, I appreciate you doing this.
No problem.
So once we get her in,
where am I sitting?
You have to have a seat right there.
It'll be the,
I always say the strap that's on the inside of the seat, so whichever way you have to lean over, that one should be the tightest to begin with. I can adjust the outside strap a little bit easier. But if I'm trying to adjust over Christy here, what is this kid doing to me? So we want to try and get that strap in, and then we can adjust from out here and be outside of your reach. We always want to be aware of where they are and where we are in space. I don't like people intruding on my space. I know we have to do it to secure them, but it's a very uncomfortable feeling for anybody to be that up close and personal. If I was this close to you talking to you all the time, how cool are you? I'm lucky I don't get spit. So once we get the hips in, you start with the inside one, then with the outside one, and you might have to secure it. Then I might have to secure this again. Loosen this up and pull it down so those hips are as far back as they can be. And then I secure the top and tighten those down. I can even tighten the top from behind if I have a student that's really having problems. What we want to watch for is we don't want this to ride up on her, because this across her neck is a safety issue. This should still be down. That's why those hips have to be back and secure and tight first. For your other students that have the crotch strap that wraps around, make sure it's not digging in. When they're upright and that crotch strap is secure and it's snug, when they sit down, it pulls against them. That's uncomfortable. And if you have a 45-minute ride, 50-minute ride, none of us would tolerate that either. We'd be struggling to try and get up as much as possible. Thank you so much. Yeah. So I always, once we get them in, get those bottom ones snuggled. You can undo your seat, pull those hips back down so that these straps are keeping your hips against the seat, and then re-secure the back. And then you can work on your top straps. Okay? Most of our kids that are in safety vests, when I see them on the bus, I don't know how many times we have watched videos where they're in their straps and they're actually up and out and about. They're tethered, but they're using that as a point of security so that they can kick across because they know that this is going to hold them in. But if their hips are firm against that seat, they're not going to be able to do that. Also, our kids that are able to unstrap, get out, if they can't get the height to get those top straps off, they can't do that because you've secured these so that once that they're in, you've adjusted them so that they're firm in the seat. If we have them secure in the seat, we're not going to have as many problems. Yes, they can still reach out and kick. They can still hit. They can still spit. They can still swear. That's a distance issue. You just stay out of their reach, right? You try to stay in spot. And try to engage them.
And separates.
So you just want to make sure that when we're using this, that we are using it correctly. That kids don't have that ability to have much movement. You want to make sure that the safety vest is providing that issue of safety. If they're able to get out of it, then we have to either go to a smaller size for the safety vest. If it's big enough that they can pull these shoulder straps down, then they just wiggle out of it eventually. I'll get you out of it. Thank you. So any questions about that? You should be adjusting every single time you put a kid in here. It's not something you set up, and then when they come in, you just hook them in and go, because if they've got that much play and stuff, they're going to be able to get out of it, and then it's not going to provide anything for you. And then it becomes a huge issue of safety, because they're not in their seats, the bus is in motion, they're aggravating other students.
Certainly, Sherry's presentation today is going to help with it. Just
engagement
and better understanding of where these behaviors might come from, so that, you know, we honestly, this is kind of flip-flop, but Wendy had to do this first, but truly, this is just setting the stage so that, because we know that many of our students who are going to our outplacements need more secure, we need to keep them safe in their seats. So that's that piece, but certainly that whole, it's not comfortable. None of us would be comfortable being strapped in on a 45-50 minute trip. It's what Sherry's going to talk about will help us to have the right frame of mind to deal with and engage, so they don't feel as though they need to spit, kick, and so forth. You see what I'm saying? So. And it's
I've also provided activity bags on buses. So if you have a kid that you need some additional support, I've put together several activity bags for, you know, this individual student that has something that they can fill with, or a coloring book, or a book to read, something that's going to keep them engaged during that. So if you need supplies like that, let Jason know. Let them know who the kids are specifically, because sometimes I know, oh, that student really likes My Pretty Ponies. So I'll look for a coloring book for My Pretty Ponies. And then it's about novelty. If I give them the same thing day after day, they're like, what the hell is this? I don't want this anymore. The other thing is that, you know, kids are kids. They're going to have good days. They're going to have bad days. So do we. We just have to remember to take ourselves out of feeding into their behavior. You know, if I get on a bus and I'm having a rough day, and I'm not looking forward to this bus ride, because if you ever notice when I get on your buses, I have a small bottle of water and a container of Tums, because I'm taking sips, so I'm not throwing up on your buses. Some of the kids, you know, I get on there and I'm like, hi, okay, let's sit down, let's have a great bus, we're going to have positive behaviors, just interacting with them. And I know it gets frustrating. I know that it's hard to do this day after day and hear the same things over again. You're stupid, I don't like you, you know, swearing at you, all of those things. But in the grand scheme of life, we're getting them home safe. In terms of, like, you know, students don't want to be hooked up and don't want to be secure. Maybe about half of you are old enough. How many of you remember when we first had to go to wearing seatbelts when it became a law? And how many of us didn't do it beforehand? How many of us were resistant to that? Didn't remember to put on seatbelts, didn't want to put on, and I'm only going across town. I don't have to wear my seatbelt. Or, hook it over your arm so that if a cop is driving by, they see that. Well, that's what our kids do. Like, they get hooked in, but they still have all this play. It's really not doing what it's supposed to do. So we just want to make sure that they're safe, that you're safe, and that we're getting them home safely every day. Mm-hmm. Questions, concerns, problems, or issues that I can assist with? All right, reach out to Jason if you guys need me for anything. All right. Thank you so much for being here today.
Good morning again. My name is Sherry White, as they mentioned. I'm with NIA. My office is in Rockford. I've been with NIA for about 24 years, so it seems like forever. I do in-service training as a piece of my job. I'm with high school kids with disabilities in the Rockford School District with job training and career placement kind of activities. And I also do program consultation across our region. But this in-service stuff, you know, passionately asked me to do it. I did it kicking and screaming initially. But as time went by and I got involved with it, I realized that, you know what, I do like this because I have a son who went through special education and is doing very well, rode the bus and all that sort of thing. My background is special ed. I'm a teacher by first profession, or first career out of college. I taught in Belvedere the very first year that they took their kids from DeKalb County School District back home to Boone County. So I don't know if any of you are that old with me, but it goes back to that time when Boone County felt that they should take their students and bring them in their own home district. So my first teaching experience was up in Belvedere, and I'm with NIA and the most proud and my ancestors. But I'd like to know who you are. How many of you are bus monitors? All right, and then the drivers? I know that's the rest of you, okay, good, good. If you would please, I would like to know if you could put your name, each table has some slips. Just put your first name and last letter, the last initial letter, Mary M, Dr. John D, whatever that might be. And I have a door prize drawing later. So, would you be the family to go around to give everybody's up? Put your name, oh, not yet. Hold up. Once you've got your name on it, the next thing I need you to put on that slip is why I like my job as a bus driver or a bus monitor. Why I like my job as, or why I like my job as a bus monitor. And it's okay to write whatever you want, because I'm not going to read your last name out loud. I'm just going to read your first name so you can win the door prize and clear your name out of the hat. So, your first name with initial, and then what I like about my job. Christy will pick up. Yeah?
I'm giving them time to say.
That's fine. That's good.
And you'll be basically
anonymous, so don't be concerned if she pulls my name, she's going to read it out loud, and I'm going to say, oh my gosh, I love that. I'm going to go to the next slide. I come from a family of bus drivers. My dear old dad retired from bus driving. He passed away a year ago in January. He had retired about 20 years from the school district. And he drove in Northeast Iowa, that's where I'm from, in a district where at that time, and probably still did, but somewhat rural, the buses are driven home and parked in their driveway or on the side. Does that happen with any of you? Does that change? Everybody takes a bus back to the...
We have other locations that have
that. Okay, all right. So I remember Dan starting the bus a lot. I went to the city school. I didn't go to the school out of town, so I wasn't on his bus. But I will tell you, when he retired, there was some little snowflake and bus there. He said to me, us, that the best thing about retirement as bus driver was having to go out and start that bus on cold mornings. He liked everything else about his job except warm the darn bus up. Now I think you plug in and you're good to go, and I don't know if you get there, is the bus already warmed up or not, but I dedicate this.
Today was perfect.
Is that?
Today was a perfect example.
Okay, here you go. Yeah. All right, so this one's for my dad. I don't really dedicate my workshops, but this one is for my dad. And my mother also retired from the school bus driving profession, so they were both bus drivers. All right, we have three things to accomplish today. We've already done one. It's a safety vest. We just kind of switched it around a little bit to accommodate Wendy's schedule. So we have two pieces left for us. The first thing is we're going to talk about behavior. Again, these are the things that we're going to offer today. I'm not telling you technical support for bus driving. I'm not going to talk about rules of the road. That's all what you get in your training through your bus company. I'm going to hopefully support helping kids have a safe and peaceful ride, helping you have a joyful ride. I'd like you to love your job. I'd love you to get on your bus in the morning and the afternoon and say, I'm ready for these kids. These kids mean the world to me. They are tough, they are challenging, there is no question. So we're gonna talk about what behavior is from a very basic level, and then talk about some strategies. So on your handout, on the white packet, if you'd like to follow along, they're on your table, with the same slides up here that I have. We'll talk about the yellow handout a little later this morning. And we're planning to have a short break, but we're going to be so squished that I'd like you to know if you need to get more coffee, another roll or something, just stand up, help yourself, step up, whatever works for you. I'd like you to ask questions as we go. I pretty much present at an informal level, so if there's something we're talking about you want to clarify, please ask. Don't be shy to do that. I have a slide in here that says break. It's a 7-minute break. I might reduce that to 3 or 4 minutes.
because we want to kind of get through as much with people's staggered schedules. I don't want to have, you know, too much crunch that we're going to miss some of the things that we're likely to have today. So that's how we're going to run our morning. We will be done by 11 for those of you who are staying. How many of you will be leaving before 11? So, at my break slide, somebody remind me, we're going to do our drawing, okay? All right, any questions so far? All righty, here we go. Behavior. When we think of behavior, I'm going to put us all in the same group right now. When we think of behavior, we think about kids kicking and screaming and spitting and farting or whatever it is they do to get us ticked off. But when we think about behavior in its truest sense, it's about any activity that can be observed. I'm observing this young man, licking his lips, twirling his napkin, not even knowing that he was doing that. Now I call his attention, he's very sensitive to it. I understand that, but that's behavior. It's what you see. It doesn't have to be aggressive. It doesn't have to be verbally abusive. It doesn't have to be a meltdown. It can be just what is observed. That's what behavior is. What we want to take it down to, though, is its communication. If I'm in workshops and grants, I will have people who have their cell phones out and they're scrolling and they're texting and they're doing this and they're doing that. Their behavior to me is what I would call off task. I have some people that are sitting like this. And I know that too. They're nodding off. This isn't quite striking them. They're not quite alert with me. To me, what that tells me is they're telling me something else. You're not reaching me. There's a communication piece going on that I have to interpret. Why is she nodding off? Why is she on her phone? Does she have a crisis at home that she's trying to manage while she's here? Some of those things. But when we're talking about communication, we need to go back to what are they telling us? And her, backing up on Wendy's demonstration here, when they're uncomfortable, when they're, you know, reaching out, kicking, whatever they might be doing, they're telling us something. We usually know, I don't want to sit in this crap. That's not hard to figure out. But in other cases, if they're sitting there wild, all of a sudden they start swearing or yelling or picking up things in their backpack and throwing it. That's communication, they're telling us. Our job always is to figure out what the heck does that really mean. So we aren't always going to know, but we're going to hope to approach them on a level that we can understand their needs and we can support it through, support kids through that. So what are they telling us with their communication, with their behavior? What need is not being met? Are they hungry? Are they tired? Are they mad? Are they sad? Are they depressed? Are they manically happy? You know, kids can get to the other extreme. All of a sudden they're just buoyant and they're all over the place that way. And that's not a behavior typically seen out of a student. So there's something else that's gone on for them. And then at the end, how can we support the student with respect and dignity? Every child in our bus, every child in our classroom is somebody's child. It might be yours, and you would hope that whoever is working with that child reaches that child in a level of support with dignity and respect. It's hard. It's very hard, but let's remember, they're somebody's child, and everybody is going to come to the table doing the best we can. We've been called to do the job we're doing, and we've been called to do it in the best way we can, the best way that we know how. And utilizing the supports around us to even achieve better, such as Wendy said, reaching out to Jason, asking for those activity bags, et cetera, et cetera. We need to appreciate all this when it comes time to look at kids that are really struggling. Our kids come loaded with issues, lots of problems, don't have problem-solving skills, don't have coping skills. Their basic needs might not be met. So these are the kinds of things that we want to approach our kids, not approach in terms of a direct approach, but begin to approach from an understanding level. Okay. Keep in mind that challenging behavior is not a desire on the student's part to cause problems. It might feel like that, it might seem like that, but there's an author that I read on a lot of behavior stuff. His name is Richard LaVoy, and he, one of his quotes that I just really hold on to is, "No child intends to cause as much pain as the pain he is feeling." So we go back to behaviors communication. When a kid is acting out, whatever that might look like, it really is not about the pain he's trying to cause you or the anger he's trying to rise in you. It's more about what's happening to him internally, and you have to be the target. You're the one that's there. So let's think about that unconditional piece. It's really not about you, which brings me right to Q-tip. Have you ever heard this before? Q-tip, quit taking it personal. You are the one, you are the easiest target. You are the one that's going to be there tomorrow morning. You're going to be there tomorrow afternoon. You're going to be there on Thursday morning, on Thursday night, on Friday morning. You're going to be there all the time. You might be the most personal one, the most closest one there. You're going to be the one to absorb that. But
but let's appreciate and reach those kids with respect and dignity. It really is not about us. Feels like it, looks like it, sounds like it. It's not a duck. You heard that? Walks like a duck, talks like a duck, acts like a duck. Okay. With kids with behavior issues, it's a behaviorist communication. Please take that home with you today. In your mind, they're telling us something. There's a need not being met, and don't take it personal. Don't take it personal. Easier said than done. It takes practice. And we might be sensitive people, our feelings might be hurt and affected. And how can a kid talk to me like that? And we're there to hear that language. Oh my gosh, he's only 3 years old. Well, I've heard from different people that have early childhood kids. They say, and they know how to use those words in the right context. All right? That's the least of your problems. Verbal aggression is there. You're going to drive the bus, and you're going to drive it safely. When you start responding to all of that stuff, you are feeding into it, and that creates the behavior to continue. So some of the stuff would be good about ignoring, but to quit taking it personal. So two things, and if you don't do nothing else, behavior is communication, there's some need not being met, and quit taking it personal, Q-tip. Does that work for you? Go home now? All right. Let's not go home quite yet. All right. I'm going to pass this slide up because I think Wendy addressed some of the problems that you might see on the bus. I've kind of handed around them. I kind of want to keep going so we get through some material. In a longer time, you guys are going to tell me what behavior to see on your bus, and I think we all share in common kids that have behavioral issues, behavior problems. So kind of keep moving. All right. I've given you the answer to this already. Why do you think students have challenging behaviors? Go back to that there's a need not being met. That need can be basic, it can be they need food, they need shelter, they need safety at home. They didn't get it what they needed at school. They might be hungry, they might be full, they might be constipated. Our kids, they have a lot of digestive issues, a lot of bowel issues. That's a pretty uncomfortable feeling. And if you're sitting on a bus at a school all day and they go home on the bus 45 minutes and you're stuck, it hurts. I used to work at Miles in my next classroom. I went to Milestone in Rockford for a period of time. And it was interesting. Milestone is a residential facility for adults. They've expanded out of Rockville with children. When I was there, it was strictly adults with pretty significant disabilities. And our nursing staff would find that when one of our individuals would act out and have a behavior crisis or cause an injury or something, and they would do a check, a body check on the student, on the individual, what they would find is, and this is so, it still baffles me. They would oftentimes find their toenails had to be cut. And think about when your toenails are too long, your shoes, how uncomfortable it is, and you're working with people, in this case, Milestone, who are nonverbal, intellectually disabled, could not tell you what the problem was, so they would act out, and that's what they would find. Trim the toenails up, get on a regular schedule, behaviors would go down. Basic needs aren't being met sometimes, and that's the piece that we want to really kind of hone in on and focus. So that's why students have challenging behaviors. Their needs are not being met. When their needs are not being met, they can do it for a couple different reasons. They might want attention. They might be craving that. They maybe didn't get enough at school. Maybe their usual paraprofessional wasn't there. Maybe their teacher had a sub in today. Maybe the OT wasn't there. Maybe the physical therapist wasn't there. Maybe that special janitor was out. Our kids in special education love the janitorial staff. Love them. It is a reward generally to go shake the rugs, vacuum the rugs, wipe off the locker handles, whatever. Those are reinforcing things. If they didn't get that piece of attention, that might be what they're trying to tell us. I need your attention. We're going to talk about positive attention a little bit. They might want to escape or avoid. They might want to escape this business. As we said, it's too tight. We're going to get comfortable for 45 minutes. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand, but I still know some people who take their seatbelt strap and slide it behind them when they drive because it's more comfortable with them. It's not as safe anymore, but again, they might need to avoid the situation. They might not like the other kid on the bus, some of those reasons. They may have possession of something tangible. They don't have what they want. They don't have what they need, or whatever that could be. Sensory, I'm sure you've had some training on sensory issues with kids with autism. A little bit. Radio's too loud. Radio's not on. Somebody passed gas and it smells. All kinds of things kids relate to. I don't know if any of you are hearing the hum of the lights in here. Okay, that's interfering for some of our kids. They can't filter that out. They can't process it. They can't stop it. So if you're, I don't know if your buses have radios in where there's chatter going on between the bus company and you possibly. That could be background stuff that just sets them off. It could be the static. It could be the voice of the person on the other end. All these things that we can't even necessarily identify come into play, how, why these kids might be acting out. Power and control. Some kids really do want to have some control. And really, it's okay for you as a driver or a monitor to find some things that the kids can control on the bus. No, they can't take your steering wheel. No, they can't move your dials. No, they can't use this or that. I know that. But there's some other things that bus monitors can support them with doing. We'll get to some of that in a little bit. Crazy way to think about your job. But again, if we want to have a safe and peaceful ride, we're going to go outside the box and think about what can we do to give these kids that are seeking some power and control that opportunity. If I give them the right power and control, we have things better in check. So far, so good?
Yes.
I know I talk very quickly. If I'm going way too fast, give me this. I'm okay with that. All right?
Okay. And finally, the student would not continue to use the behavior unless it had been effective, at least some of the time, in helping them to meet their need or purpose. So if they're constantly spinning or kicking or throwing, and you keep saying, John, settle down. John, please stop. All that is feeding into him doing it. He might be seeking attention. He might not be. Some of the stuff we've learned to ignore. If it's not hurting anybody, anything, or anybody else, we can just ignore it. If they swear at you, ignore it. If you respond to that, they'll keep swearing at you. So kind of keep those behavioral principles in mind, what their functions might be. ACEs. This is something that's kind of sweeping our country. There was a gentleman who kind of left his traditional school position and ran a school for kids that were completely difficult, crisis-laden, unable to have their needs met in the public school. A self-contained school of kids that were at risk. And what they've done is they've identified what we're calling ACEs, adverse childhood experiences. There's about 22 different ACEs that they've identified that truly affect kids and how they respond to traditional settings, how they respond to work, how they ride in buses, et cetera, et cetera. Now, there's like 22 examples of them all. We have all ourselves probably experienced some of these ACEs in our own lives, might be experiencing them now. The reason we bring that out today is to talk about, we don't know the home lives of some of these kids. We don't know what's going on between parents, between grandparents, between brothers, between sisters, who might be incarcerated, who didn't come home last night because they got thrown in jail because they were at the bars, they caused a fight, yada, yada, yada. Anybody see This Is Us, the final episode last night? They watched that program, This Is Us. Not quite the way we thought it was going to end. But anyway, these are the ACEs. Our kids live in environments that have ACEs. And I know the DeKalb County school area has had a higher increase of lower income families. Lower income families that live in some poverty have a lot of other kinds of issues just by the nature of survival. These things are real in their lives. The reason I want to talk about them is because something happens in the kid's brain when they're experiencing ACEs. The frontal lobe part of our brain is the area that we can think, we can process, we can make decisions, we can stop something, we can start something, we can manage it. It's the powerhouse, it's the CEO of our brain. In the back of our brain, in the limbic system, that is where our body, our brain chemistry has a fluid called cortisol. And what happens is when we get truly upset, something has made us angry, whatever, that limbic system back here floods the brain with cortisol and this shuts down. The brain chemistry has changed. These ACEs have caused that limbic system to go into fright or flight. When they're in fright or flight, there's not a chance to reason. So that's why we have to understand the nature of behavior. We have to appreciate circumstances so we can meet them on a level that this brain can function at a more even level. They might not. I have a situation going on right now in my life, my work life, not my personal life, that just by the sound of the thought of it, I can feel my brain, I can feel myself running on the attack. I can feel it. It's so upsetting to me. I can't even hardly think rationally. Think about a time that you've experienced that has been that frustrating for you, or you were so mad that, I was so mad I couldn't even talk. I was so mad I couldn't even, have you been there? Yeah. Even though it's, oh, it's okay, you know, come with me, let me all right, you know, does that help? No, it does not help. So when kids are at that alert level, they're at that crisis state, oh, all this food talk, all this sweetness, oh, come on, come and sit, you know. No, they're not there. The brain chemistry is more powerful than even you. So we have to let that come back down before we can really reason with them. And when kids have behaviors that escalate, as that behavior builds, when it gets up here, this is done, this is done. There's no way to make an intervention that's successful. It's after the effect that maybe having a conversation or action with them, using the support team, however that might need to be. When the kids are up here, it can't be effective. It can't be. Don't try to be. The brain's got you, their brain has got you over it, Carol. Can't be. So just kind of be aware of that with the ACEs, with the conditions of what might be their situation at school, what happens, and you can't make an impact until later. And then we have kids with cognitive disabilities, may not even understand all the consequences or all the policies and procedures, or talking about it tomorrow when it happened yesterday, the connection might not be there. So we have to appreciate those circumstances as well. All right, how to overcome ACEs. We can't change family income. We can't only change neighborhood they might live in, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. What we can do is we can become a person that they attach to. There's been studies shown that every child that has one caring, stable adult in their life has a 20% chance, even greater, than being a successful adult. So when we can hook into kids and be that one caring, stable adult, the chance of them doing well is so much better. So as a bus aide, or a bus monitor, as a bus driver, as a student support service center, as a supervisor program, can we be that person? As I mentioned, some of our kids in special ed really do like having to support the janitor with his work, her work, whatever that might be. Wow, you know, that's that one person's stable, caring adult. That might be the person that made a difference. When my dad died, you would not believe all the kids that came through the visitation kids. They're now adults having children, of course, you know, maybe even grandparents by now. You cannot believe the number of people that came through the line that sent my mom a card. Somebody from Arizona sent her a card. I heard that Gene died. I'm so sorry. He was the best bus driver I ever had. How many years back does that go? Was my dad one of those stable caring adults for one of those kids? Probably for some, yes, but you can also be that person. And I'm going to show you a little clip on that. I've done this workshop other places, but one gal in my group one time said that she used to be a crossing guard, and now she's working at Hy-Vee as well as the school district. And somebody came through her line, and that person said to her, "Do you remember me?" And she said, "I'm not sure." She said, "Well, I'm so-and-so, and you were the crossing guard at such and such a corner." And she said, "I look forward to seeing you every day." And she said, "You did? Why? Why do you think that student looked forward to seeing that crossing guard?"
She's probably
nice. Pardon me?
She's probably nice.
She was nice, but what does that mean? What does that mean as a crossing guard being nice to her? She smiled. Smiled and said, "Hello, good morning. What's your name?"
Jar.
Yep. Okay. Good morning, Jar. How are you? Okay? You know, that's the stuff that mattered to her. That was the first person she saw on her way to school. So let's think about always who can be that one person. We might want to be that one person, but it may not be us. Might be somebody else, and that's okay. But think about these kids that need that person in their life. Okay, I'm going to show you this little clip. This is a bus driver, my mouse, sorry, where are my tools? But I was done with this.
It's so many first people drivers, locations, and they could have chosen anybody that they chose. I enjoy my job. I really appreciate what I do. It is challenging, but it's also fun. And when you enjoy what you do, I think that everything else will fall suit. One of my sister's parents wrote a letter. She said that she enjoys that every day she put a child on my bus that I'm smiling. I think that it is true. That when you smile and you start off the day with a hello, good morning, and you have a good day, and just keep the kids knowing that somebody is wanting them to have a good day. But we can always do it together and just continue to love the kids. It makes a huge difference. So, versus someone not here and send you on your way. You don't know what these children have to go through. You don't know where they've been or what they have to go back home to. But if we all just care for them together, they'll always have that motivation.
The reason I like that for a number of reasons, one reason is that life as a school bus driver for most begins first thing in the morning. While your little ones are getting ready for the reason I like that is because it's a testament to somebody, a group of people that voted her or nominated her or recognized her as really one caring bus driver. We all share the frustrations that come on our bus loads every day. So if, let's say, you have heard through your grapevine, I know you all have a grapevine, but you have heard that one bus driver or one bus monitor was really supportive, effective, made a difference, it's important that we praise our colleagues. We need to let them know. What's your first name?
Carl.
Carl? All right, Carl did something fabulous. We don't know what, I mean, you know what it was. Let's just say he did something fabulous with the kid that was really difficult. What's your name?
Kim.
Kim heard about it. Kim is not on Carl's bus, but she's on in the company. She's going to see Carl. Carl, rock that. I heard about this. This is awesome. Now, we always respect confidentiality. Get that, too. But we work with difficult kids. We have hard jobs. It's important that we build each other up because we need to keep our mojo going because we are going to come back day after day after day. So that's one reason why I like her. I like that video because it recognizes that she was recognized amongst her peers. That's really important to me. Okay, this gal, do you know why the school bus driver is such an important person? This is her take. This is Polly Barth, and she is a speaker on lots of school topics. And this one.
I want to talk about a staff member today, a very specific staff member, someone who makes a huge difference, either makes or breaks a child's day sometimes. Let's talk about the bus driver. How many times do we see bus drivers who struggle with 75 children on the bus? I would struggle with 75 children in the back seat of my car, let me tell you. Seatbelts or no seatbelts, it doesn't matter. You have a moving classroom of 75 kids on there, all different ages. Think about it, without anybody there to help you. But I want you to think about the impact that you, the bus driver, has on that child on a daily basis. You're the first adult to see that child in the morning that's related to school when they get up those three stairs. That good morning makes a huge difference, just a little bit of contact. Set the tone in that moving classroom right from day one of your expectations and also getting to know those kids. Believe it or not, it may seem impossible, but you can get to know 75 children. And think about the end of the day. That child goes down those stairs and gets off that bus. You're the last adult that's related to school that sees that. That makes a difference. Whether we like it or not, or believe it or not, the bus is an important part of our day. It sets the tone for the day, and it ends that tone at the end of the school day. My daughter was a rather quiet child when she was in school, but there's one person she remembered. His name was Mr. Ron, the bus driver. Now, who would think that your child would remember the bus driver? But Mr. Ron said good morning every morning. Mr. Ron says good afternoon and have a nice afternoon. Mr. Ron said, have a great vacation. And Mr. Ron said, I can't wait to see you tomorrow. Hope you had a great night. Those little things are at home in your moving classroom with those 75 kids that can make a huge difference in their day. When we do bus driver training, we like to teach a lot of other people how not to take things personally, how not to get engaged with the child who's acting out, how to set that tone, be consistent with that tone, and also build a relationship that has appropriate boundaries, but yet tells a child that it matters when they go up those stairs with us in the morning.
Save her for the next part. Any questions so far? Comments? Okay. You guys are an easy group. Yes.
As a driver and the attendant, can we find out what the issue is with the child?
What the behavior issue is? What the losses?
Yes. No, what the, like if they're autistic?
Oh, what the diagnosis and eligibility is? Yeah. I'll refer to you.
There is some information that is available, but it's, we don't always have every little detail of the general view of that information.
Child has some sensory needs, would you be informed of that? I mean, is that the kind of thing you're asking about, or what they're regarding? Yeah. I mean, I'm sure they know which kids have epilepsy, might have seizures, which kids are diabetic, which might have, you know, reactions, whatever.
I didn't know anything, and then one student came up to the bus and she stopped. And then I said, where are you going? Then she came to and she explained to us that she has seizures.
And seizures are not always just thrashing on the bus board, arms and legs going. Seizures can be a blank stare, they can be a dropped head, they can be, you know, ticking, lip smacking, be a lot of different things. I don't know, I don't want to put your answer.
I think that the issue with that is yes, yes, you should and could have that information. And what we've been, and Jason and I have talked a little bit about this as well as with Brenda, Jurgens, the liaison, is we're worried about that, not that you're going to share that confidential information, but where will we keep that confidential information? You see?
Yes.
And so some have said, oh, I don't know, some sort of binder, but whenever we put it in paper and then there's a binder on the bus, is it okay? That's the piece that we're trying to work through. And I'm not, and there's been turnover quite a bit that then this information, you know, is out there. So we have to find, I agree with you, we have to find some confidential way to share that information with you so that you know, oh, okay, I need to be aware that the student has epilepsy. Or, boy, it would have been nice to know that this student has sensory. I think sensory is one of those big things because you may not be realizing why is a student acting out, but it's because John is tap-tap-tap-tap-tap-tapping messing over, or that squawking on the radio is driving them over the top, right? Or that they're about to student, you know, whatever. So thank you for reminding us that we need to come to a happy place and a good place and give that information to them.
And sometimes that's also there's directed by the parents that kind of guide us to. Some parents want you to know everything, and that's their prerogative. There are some parents that want you to have very limited information. That's also their prerogative, and you're guided by HIPAA, so that our hands are kind of tied on some of that stuff. So that's why that's like that. It's almost a case by case. But in general, yes, you do have access to information.
Okay, thank you for the question. Anything else? Okay, I told a little bit of my dad and the, you know, cards and the guests that came through the line, etc. This is my son, Matt. This is a sixth grade picture. I know we have drivers in here that take students from DeKalb School District to another location that's out of the district because their needs are better for being met there. We always want to have our kids in the least restricted environment. Some of our kids need that special school placement. The long-term goal is always to bring those students back to a less restrictive place. It might be at some point this year, it might be 2 years from now, it might be 5 years from now, depending on what the student's needs are. Same thing on the bus. How many of you drive a regular school bus that maybe has 30 or 40 kids? Are there any of those drivers here? Okay, a couple, all right. The rest of you are driving more of a minibus with 6 or 8 students? Okay. Matthew had a brain tumor when he was a baby. He was 2. He had chemo and surgery. He's 23 now, has some deficits, but healthy, doing very, very well. In second grade, he said to us, he went to Rockford Public Schools, and he was taking Septran, now it's Sunrise in Rockford. But he said, why don't I take the big bus? And we said, I don't know. Because he was getting some special services, it seemed to be automatic. But when he said that, we took a look at that and said, yeah, why are you? And he has mobility issues, and he had to have a special request from the doctor to the school nurse to have a bus stop on our corner rather than a block away because of the mobility issues he has and the stuff. So he ended up always having a pretty good seat in the bus. The bus driver took care of that. You know, we told her what happened. I told her because I was getting out there, so the confidentiality piece came right from the mom, you know, and so forth. But he's had some great experiences. But we always work to develop a relationship with the bus driver. That person would get my kids safely someplace, but I hope it's just school and back. So the first thing we need to talk about today, besides what we have as far as how we're going to help our kids, we're going to build a relationship with them. When they're angry and mad, we're still going to be building a relationship with them. We're not taking that personally. We're going to get past that. So the first thing in your small bus, it's probably pretty easy to learn the kids' names. Jack, have that done. Greet them each day by name. Now, let's say they got the hair on the back of your neck growing up. You're taking them home. The last thing you want to do is say goodbye, because you yourself are so mad. And we're going to feel that way. But you know what your job still will be? Goodbye, Jart. Have a good night. I can't wait to see you tomorrow. You might have to force that smile, but you have to say it like you mean it. You have to look like you mean it. These are the pieces. And that kid might not hear you, but when you set that practice and repeat it, day after day, he will wait for you to say it. He might stop his tracks and he didn't say it. Does he call you Jart?
Oh, no, they call me Jared.
Jared? Okay. So let's say when he forgot to say something and you've done it enough times it's become routine, the kid's going to turn around and say, Jerry, you're going to say goodbye. He might be waiting for you to do that. We have to build this practice up, even when it doesn't feel right for us to say it. Number two, comment on their hobbies, their cool clothes, their backpack, paper they're carrying home. We need to be noticed. It's human nature. We need to be noticed. Good and bad, we need to be noticed. Power kids, leaders who have negative influence and discipline on the and influence overall discipline on the bus. We might have some kids who can control the atmosphere on the bus. They have the power to set everybody off. All right, how are you going to counter that? Catch them being good. When they're not in control, they're not, you know, upsetting the apple cart. Notice them being good. Notice what they're wearing. Ask who their teacher was. Where they sit by at lunch. Anything you can think of quickly to get that out there so that you can detract them and bring them on board with the conversations appropriate. And usually when I do like a bowling workshop or some other things, this is the time to catch those kids that are difficult when they're not difficult. Catch them now, build that relationship. Number four on your bus, don't identify my favorites or use nicknames. You know, the honey, sweetheart, sweetie, get rid of that stuff. Or if they have a nickname that's, I don't know, let's say a kid already has a nickname that everybody uses, that's acceptable. Don't create pet names. This doesn't work so well. All right, any school environment should be the happiest place on earth for our kids. We should be giving them a positive, successful educational day. We need to first build relationships and we have to build connectedness. We build kids up, such as one driver, or this actually came from a cafeteria worker, who in another school district said she would go to the office elementary school every day and take a look at the absentee list. And she would see who was missing. And they would come back the next day in the cafeteria. What's her first name? Latrice. All right, let's say Latrice is missing today. She comes back tomorrow. And I'm going to say, I'm going to use a script right off the screen. Latrice, you were absent yesterday at this bus. Isn't this good? You're not here. Even if she's the one that is your app, the one that's upset your app, it's just the most good thing. I'm not here. I really miss you. I cared about her. I noticed she wasn't there. That might have been the only stroke you've gotten all day with anybody. But it's true. You're not there. That's good. Right. You can treat her every day. So find a little line that she can use. You were absent yesterday. I missed you. This bus isn't as good without you. Might be hard. Might not be fun. And you might not feel it. It's not about your feelings. It's about building that relationship with the kid. Okay, this was said in, I think, the first video and the second one. They both said, say their name. We've heard that over and over. Say their name, say their name, say their name. Same thing, I want to know who Jerry is. I want to know who Carl is. I want to know who Latrice is. I can't know all of you today, but it's important that I know who you are and what your job is. I want to make an impact on you. That means I'm really glad you're here, and I am. You guys have other things you can be doing. You're probably getting paid to be here, so that's okay. But still, say their name. Every day, as grumpy as you might feel, you might have a headache, you might have a stomach ache, you might have sore back, you might have all kinds of things. You might have somebody very sick at home, you might have somebody long distance away from you that's needing your help. Regardless, we are on the job for those hours being the best that we can be to make the kids the best that they can be.
I know we talked about how we're going to make this work, and I'm going to stress over and over, it's about relationships. We have to start with relationships with the kids. Here are some strategies that we can use as drivers, as monitors, as hall monitors, staffs, as principals, as teachers, whatever it might be. We need to notice kids. We say two I-know statements each week. Let me think, I'm going to talk about the videographer here in a minute, okay? I said, hello, you know, did I ask your name directly? I know it's Ben.
No, that's all the guy you're inquiring about. Oh, Brandon.
Okay, all right. But I wanted to find out who he was and then be videoing him. Make you look good. You know, if you're going to use this again, put me up in that basic halfway decent. It's important that I would find out who he was. I noticed that your name is Ben. I know somebody else named Ben from the IT department, but I was a little bit wrong. I tried to strike a connection. Same thing with kids. Find out what you might have in common. Who's a White Sox fan? Who's a Cub fan? Who's a Bear fan? Who's a Pack fan? You know, and it might be that fun rival. You're a Cubs fan, I'm a White Sox fan. It's fun to have some advantage. Did you have a question? No? I thought you had your hand up. All right, so I noticed you're wearing your Green Bay Packers shirt today. You like those Packers? What about the Bears? Oh, Jay Cutler got cut loose. You know, then you've got a relationship going. You've got something to talk about. Okay. Be careful of this one. When it says one physical touch per week, physical is always questionable. Be careful. But there's lots of ways to move physical touch that's meaningful and appropriate. High five, it doesn't have to be a touch. It can be a kiss up in the air. It can be a pat on the back. I know you're sitting in your seat while the kids are loading. Can you do a handshake? Can you do a fist bump? Can you do one of these things? And what can you do to connect with them? Something. It might be just the one thing you pick out that's between you and that kid. But that's the handshake you guys have. Has anyone read the book, The Curious Incident of the Dog in the Night? The book cover has a panel of the dog upside down. All right, it's a long story, but I'll tell you what. This boy has autism, and the way he hugged his mother, I'm going to use, I lost your name already.
Gary.
What is it?
Gary.
Gary. All right. Gary, can you do this with me, please? Put your finger up like that. This is how this boy hugged his mother. They just touched fingertips. That was a hug. That was all the child could tolerate. For the mother, that was the embrace. So find something that works with the physical touch that's appropriate. Some kids don't want to be touched. Don't touch. You know, don't try to nurture that. Find something else. Find a wink. Find a thumbs up. High five. Something like that. All that stuff matters. Get in the vicinity once a week. Well, you're in the vicinity every day. They're on your butts. So that one doesn't quite apply as it does to some of the classroom settings. Smile at them twice a week. Smile at them twice a day. You got morning, you got night, double up twice in the morning, twice in the afternoon. When they come on, they're thinking, I don't want to see this kid again today. But he's here. You have to. It's not about you. All right? It's about them. You're going to be that one caring, stable person. You're going to make that ride good for that kid. All right. Thumbs up. We talked about that. And then again, here it is. I can't say enough. Use their names. Use their name. Use their name. Use their name. Use it positively. Be friendly and happy. Back to relationships. I mentioned my dad died. I mentioned he had my desk come through with the car, et cetera. One of the more touching things was 20 years later, the Bus Drivers Association sent flowers to the home. Isn't that amazing? Now, I can say it's small town Iowa. I can say that, yes. But 20 years later, maybe it's a policy, maybe every deceased bus driver gets a bouquet. I don't know. Forget it. And you know what? That mattered to us. That mattered to my family. So he obviously had relationships. And my dad, you know what? He had a GED. He got his GED when I was in eighth grade. Neither of my parents, at eighth grade, they quit school and they became farmhands and we call them nannies now. Hired help is what the term was then. I went on to get a master's degree. My dad knew I was a teacher. He knew what that looked like. He knew what that sounded like. He didn't get it when I said I knew in service training. He didn't get that. I finally said, Dad, it's like when the priest stands in the pulpit and you preach a message, I do that with a group of people. I stand in front of a group and I talk about something. Is that easy? Because I was still a teacher in his mind. But it doesn't matter what degree you have. It doesn't matter how much money you make. It doesn't matter. It's all about relationship building. And I really, like I said, this is my dad because he really kind of impressed upon us how important it was to be people-oriented. And he had tough kids. He had tough kids. He also would see, you know, kids with Down syndrome oftentimes have a lot of respiratory issues, a lot of pneumonia, maybe hospitalized, etc. Kids with asthma. They never go to the hospital and see those kids. There was a kid named, Bill. Bill had Down syndrome. And he would go to the hospital, and Dad would go out and see him. He'd have his menu there. In the olden days, he had a piece of paper, he would circle what you want for your meals, and Ben and Bill, whatever, he would circle everything.
they would say, what do you have for lunch today, Ben?
Everything, Gene, everything.
Everything would go in. You know, so Dad just had that knack, without even thinking hard about how to do it. So, relationships. Okay, we talked about that. Be that one caring, stable person. And I hope you believe this is true. Anyone can drive a car on the street, but it takes a special person to drive a bus driver. I really think that it does. So please know, Christy mentioned that, I'm gonna forget it right, I'm gonna piggyback on it. Your job is hugely important to the safety and the well-being of the kids and their families. Because remember, when they're on your bus, then they get off your bus. If they're in a crisis mode, if they're in a mood that's affected, that goes on at home. That has to be undone at home. We have our kids 6 hours a day. It's put 7.5 depending upon their bus ride. We have them that long. The other 16, 17, 18 hours a day is spent at home. We can be successful with these kids for the short time we've got. We need to be. They are not trying to inflict pain on us. They're experiencing some kind of emotional distress, something they're basically not being met. We are about that. It's not about us. It's about helping them get past some of those issues they might have. Right. I want to talk a bit about building community on your bus. Now, there's very few of you in here who have a large, long bus. When I did this workshop with North Moon drivers last year, most of their drivers were regular bus drivers, if you will. So we talked about things that you can do. I know I'm from Rockford. You can't have hats in school. Hats off. I have consumer policy here, too. But can you do it on the bus? Can you have a hat day? Can you have a sports jersey day? Can you do something that builds community on your bus? What can you do that's the same? I don't know what your treat deal is. My parents always had treats at Christmas time. It could be candy canes or whatever. I don't know, have special diets, I understand that. Can you defer to the food on the bus, treats? No, okay.
What they can do, maybe do stickers and erasers, different things like that. Certificates we have, and
okay.
Different things like that.
Okay. Who's not community on your bus going? Share with us what you've got. Who's doing, yes, go ahead. Put a louder.
What I do with my students, I call it like special Fridays with a special day. So if they exhibit proper bus behavior, sitting in their seats, you know, getting along with everybody, I would go by the dollar store and get like puzzles or coloring books.
Okay.
And, you know, hand them out.
So you're using Fridays kind of for some days. And that's cool that you say Fridays because a lot of teachers assign tests on Fridays. So it's a hard day at school. Think about that. Yes. Okay. And I bet they look forward to Fridays on your bus. But there's something there for them. Okay. All right. She's holding them accountable.
Yeah.
All right. Who else has something going? Yes.
My bus driver here, Natasha. She has a reward in the morning.
You weren't the girl in the movie, were you? I just popped it up on YouTube, so I don't know. Tell us about it.
So, I just buy random things that I hear them talking about in their life, whether it's us and they bring a bus, something like that. And if they behave and they have the morning and afternoon, I do it every day, so it depends on how exceptional their behavior is. Because some days, it's like really rough, they get on the bus.
Domestic violence, I'm not sure what cause it's for. But it might be appropriate for you and some of your kids. It might not be for some of your kids. I'm just throwing this out there as an idea. Could you get some red nose and it's Bozo Day? And you wear your Bozo Day nose on the bus and you put it here in my basket and you get that bottle and wear it again tonight when you come home. It's novel. It's fun. It's different. What can you do to help them connect to you and be on that bus and want to be there? Christy?
You know, I was just wondering, you had asked me about this, Sherry, about PBIS.
Okay.
And I know, Jason, that we talked about PBIS in the past, but that's positive behavior interventions and supports. And maybe you've seen your kids come on the bus with paws, little pieces of paper, paws, or tiger tickets, or what's it?
Dinosaurs.
For founders? Is that founders type?
Okay.
No. It's like little pieces of paper. Now, I said to Sherry that, you know, we do PBIS in all of our elementaries and in our middle schools. We also do it at the high school level too, but it's not as based on the pause. It's not, it's a little different. But every building has that. If you are going and you want to be a part of that, our principals would support that and give you those tickets. Now, if you're feeling like you don't want these tickets all over the floor and everything, because, you know, I get that, and kids may not have a place to put them. I get that. There are other ways that you can track. You were saying, somebody said, I go and I get little things, right? You guys, I go and I get little things. There's something, an app, that if you have your, it's up to you, Jason, but there is an app. You can keep track of Classroom Dojo. You can keep track of the kids on your bus and all the great things that they're doing. And by Friday, if you have 10 positives by Friday, then that's your opportunity. You see, you can kind of, or maybe you have a little sticker chart or something for each week. It depends on how many kids you have on your bus and how you want to work it, but certainly, I'd be happy to work with you on a system if you're interested in some system. If you want to work with your schools, it depends on who you're driving, like for what grade level that you're driving, grade school, middle school, both, high school. That kind of depends. So I was a little hesitant to bring that up because it really depends on which level that you're working.
I wanted to bring this slide up. It comes very late in the presentation, but Pinky Teller, this is from North Boone, Upper Elementary and Middle School. They took their PBIS model, be respectful, be responsible, be safe, and they translated to what bus behavior that looked like. And then the bus drivers had, they had the bucks for, I put the decal mask up there, whatever. They had the bucks for that school that they could use. So they defined exactly what be respectful on the bus looked like.
My hat's overflowing. Job, okay?
I may not have names on it, just keep it a little bit more anonymous for you, but I'll just go ahead and have the tag out. All right. The first person that wins is Luke C, and he says, I love the job 95.9 bus driver. Who's Luke C? Oh my gosh, come on down. All right. Bag of candy. Here you go. Yeah.
All
right. Second winner. I like my job of driving because it changes every day. Every day is different. Right off. Kenneth D.
Right here.
Oh, yes, yes. There's nothing that's open. It was that as an issue. All right. My next one, Amanda C, I think it is, or G. I love my kids.
She's gone.
She's gone? Who knows Amanda G?
She's lost it.
Jason, turn around.
Yeah, C and yeah,
okay. 74?
Yeah.
Yeah, perfect. All right. So I'll have all these typed up. Send it to Jason and Chris, and they can get them in your mailbox. All righty. Thanks for playing the game. So come when we started this morning, somebody said, are you Brenda? And I just wanted to let everybody know, who doesn't know, this is Brenda Jurgens. Brenda is our today's in relationships, that's critical. When we start relationship building, the rest falls away. And as I went around the break and had the Navy Strong, the gals in the back, they work together a month and a half, they feel strong as a team. She's been giving one little guy the driver, she said that, what's your first name? Tasha. That's a video, yeah. Tasha said she has a kid, we use his name Sebastian. How do you say it? You do it. I'm like, Sebastian! And at first, what happened? And he was just like, stop it. But every morning I did blushing because he's waiting for it. So she's made a connection to him. So that's the piece that really starts with managing behavior. And you don't have problems when your bush is at bush.
All right.
We want to drive our bus thinking this. I will not let you be anything less than what you're capable of being. What would you be? Anything less than what you're capable of. Do we all perform at 100% of our job every single day, all day long? Of course not. So we never give the kids those days, but it's just not going to be the same day as it usually is. We're just having a very tough time. But let's hold them accountable. And that's another thing we talked about with her at the break a little bit. It was like, who is that on Friday? Is that you? Yeah, and they don't get it on Friday. She says, we got to work harder. And they step it up. It means something. That's the piece I haven't mentioned. Whatever that something is, it has to be wanting. They want to have it. It has to be rewarding. It has to be desirable. Okay? All right. So, don't let them be less than they can be. Give them a little bit of time off sometime because everybody can't be 100% all the time. Always use the name of their school. Please honor, I'm going to use DeKalb High School. Please honor DeKalb High School's policy of appropriate language and bus safety. If we as bus drivers and bus monitors use the same phrase for all the kids all the time, it becomes natural. They will know that it's expected on this bus and that bus, not to switch buses, but just so that if you guys switch buses or whatever, you're using the same language. And if you're picking up an elementary school, is Little John one of your buildings?
Yes.
Okay. Please honor Little John's school policy on appropriate language and bus safety. And hope that's been trained or taught so that they know what that bus safety looks like.
I was on a big bus for about 6 months. And we had some rough kids on that bus. And whenever I would say, excuse me, please watch your language. And within 3 weeks, every time someone would come, the whole bus would say, excuse me, please watch your language.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, that's good.
And if we change that, you know, that's making it personal to them, you're not, you know, we're just going to still call them and say, please honor. Bus language, you know, if it's not a personal attack, then it's fine. It was working, the bus was in chorus with you.
Yeah.
So that's pretty cool also. You know, you got your community going. And when you have the peer support, they're going to hold each other accountable. Okay, very good. All right, so empathy. Let's go back to ACEs for a minute. Some of us may have grown up in environments that created many ACEs in our lives. We might still be experiencing some of those ACEs. We might have alcohol in our family. We might have divorce in our family. We might have bankruptcy in our family. We might have addiction in our family. We might have a lot of ACEs still. When our kids are being formed and the brain is developing, this is what they know. And they're in that fight or flight mode. We need to come to that at a level of empathy. Not necessarily sympathy. Empathy. We don't want to ever say, I know just how you feel, Jerry. I don't. He and I might come from divorced families, but his divorced family is from my divorced family. If you've seen one divorced family, you've seen one divorced family. All right? We can't know exactly what they're feeling, but we can empathize with them. I'm sorry that you're feeling that way today. That must be really tough. Okay? Back to our I notice. Let's build them up. Let's help them appreciate who they are, what they're doing, what they're going to be when they're with you. That 45 minutes might be the best day of their best time of their day. So kind of keep those things. I must be empathetic so that we understand they come from places that might not be our belief system, might not be our value system, might not be the way we were raised. Never swear at an adult. You might have been taught that. Never swear. Take it farther. You swear at an adult, and boy, you know what's going to happen at home. You know, that's different. People don't have the same behavioral structure, the behavioral expectations. We can't default. We'll talk about default in a minute. Because that's what we know or how we were raised doesn't mean that's what they know. That's how they're being raised. And again, it's not about you being called a son of a bitch. You might be, but it's because that's what's in their life, and you're going to ignore that. Why would you say I'm going to write you? No. Ignore that stuff. It's not about you. It sounded like it was about you, but it wasn't. All right. I'm going to have to skip this part, but I'm just going to briefly say, when kids are having some issues, we have to take a look at ourselves and how am I feeling? If you're feeling annoyed, the kid needs attention. If you're feeling angry, the kid needs firmer limits. You have to draw the line in the sand and say, enough. We don't get that prize on Friday because blah, blah, blah. And then don't give the prize on Friday. That's what firmer limits is all about. Hold it to what you called it out to be. Because once you give in, you've lost your credibility. They're going to push your envelope. Behavior's going to continue. You need to draw that line in the sand. You need to stand behind it. It might be tough. Behavior will sometimes slow up when there's some resistance and pushback, but it will go down. As Sebastian, now he stands and giggles in front of him. Not that it was a behavior problem, but she's kind of shaped him. She's molded him. She's, prefaced him to know that when you get on the bus, I'm going to say, he's the best guy! You know, he's waiting for that. So the same thing, when they need lines drawn, draw it and stay behind it. Okay, power struggles. You have a yellow color, you can call it buff on the table. Power struggles. One side says variable that affect compliance, and the other side says power struggles. Here's a bunch of strategies on how to deal with power struggles. You all know what a power struggle is? When the kids draw you in, and pretty soon you've got an argument going. These are hard to get out of. So let's not get in there. I'm not going to have time to go through this, but if I could use, what was your name about the, please don't swear? Or what? Val. What was the line again?
Watch your language, please.
Watch your language, girl. I think she said, please watch your language.
Please.
Yeah, she started with please. Please watch your language. On the third strategy on the first column, use the broken record technique. That's what it was. She used the same phrase over and over and over until the point the kids were even using it. Did the swearing go down?
Okay.
Yeah. Good, good.
Because they didn't want to be
called down by the peers. That's the powerful. When we talk about peer pressure, there's positive peer pressure. Yeah, exactly. If you drive adolescents, oh my goodness, they don't want to be called out by anyone. They will toe the line pretty darn quickly when you have to call them out. So, okay. And the broken record is a technique that you generally use when they're in your face and they won't back down. You just repeat the same phrase, slower, less softly. Less softly. The same phrase.
and it might be while you're driving. Please watch your language. Please watch, you know, you may not even hear it, but you have tuned out and you're channeling a phrase that's going to be your PBIS on the bus. Okay, give choices. You need to give choices for kids that are win-win. Many of your kids can't have optional seats on the bus because of their needs. So you can't say, would you rather sit here, would you rather sit there? All right, would you like to, and you know what? You might not have to take attendance on your bus because you might have three kids. But why don't you take attendance on your bus? That's what you can give kids that need power. You take the attendance on the bus today, Jerry. Is Val here? Yep, Val's here. Is Carl here? Yep, Carl's here. How about you, Jerry? You here? Yeah, I'm here. All right, let's go. We're all here. These are things you need to build into your bus riding time that kids can have power on and doing. I don't know, how about your radios? They work? Can you play music?
No, we don't have any.
Don't have radios? Okay. What else can you do in your bus to get power choices that kids that are win-wins? They're not unsafe. They're appropriate for kids. What can you do to give kids a power piece on the bus? Yes, Christy.
I saw one time a bus video where the bus driver did a great job of this. The bus driver said, hey, let's sing the song Old MacDonald. What animal should we use? What's the next animal? And that was really powerful for this little person to keep that person going.
And on that note, if you're adolescents, let them rap a song for you. Have them create a bus riding rap. Put them in charge of something. Christy made me think of something that's in Wendy, the bag of things for the kids. I was in a workshop one time, and what the bus driver did in that workshop is, you know those pizza cardboards that you get? You can buy them in a store, but they made bingo card out of them with clothespins. And so every time, and then they put stickers in each section, so that they can find a stop sign, a bus, like traffic bingo, auto bingo. And the kids then use that clothespin, those clothespins in the bag to go around their car to get a bingo. That engages kids for a while, keeps them busy looking for things. So that was a strategy I thought was pretty easy to do. So lots of stuff in power strategy, power control issues there. But I want to show you a short video. She's going to tell you how to stop an argument in about a minute and 18 seconds, I think it is. How to stop arguing with a kid.
Stopping back and arguing. What's the best technique you can use with someone who argues? Stop talking. It's an incredible response. When someone likes to argue with me or debate with me, I stop talking. And what eventually happens to the other person? They stop talking too. Because you can't have a one-sided argument if this doesn't happen. It's hard to do that though, isn't it? It's really hard to do that. That's why I always say, if you want to change what the kids do, then we got to change the way we respond. Because when we respond differently, we get something back a little different. So if I engage in the argument, then I'm going to keep going. If I stop talking, and maybe I might not, maybe I might validate the concern, even if I think it's crazy, but the argument stops a lot faster.
It's that easy, folks, isn't it? Kids will get your goat. They will get you to do what your body doesn't want it to do. You'll sweat. You get red, blotchy neck. Things will happen to you that you didn't think were happening, but it's because that kid is getting to you. That's the time to stop talking. Because what's happening to you is that limbic system is taking over. Your emotional responses are building. You're going to that place that you cannot be reasonable anymore. And remember, quit taking it personal. It feels like it, it sounds like it, it looks like it, but it's not. Even though they are getting to you, the best way to get out of that power situation is to stop talking. And because you're feeling stronger, you need to put yourself back in control. It has to be deep breathing. In your mouth, out your nose, or vice versa. Okay. Yeah, okay, so anyway, you need to do your techniques that put you back in check. Don't get in that argument with kids. And they will win, and they might say, gotcha! And they will say that. It's okay to acknowledge that. Yeah, you have a question, Christine?
Yeah.
Kathy. Yeah, Kathy, you have really upset me, and I'm really sorry about that. You know what, I'm just going to keep driving, and we're going to move forward. You know, we're going to keep on. Stop them. And she says something back, you stop. Just like she said in the video, you just stop. Period. That means end. Don't go back with another comment. It's okay to validate that you were, yes, upset and angry, but it's done. Your limbic system will get back in check as soon as you tell it something. Okay? All right. Alrighty. Here I just said it. Their goal is to get you angry so they can focus on your anger rather than what their problem might be. Begin calming consistently and don't overreact to loud, boisterous kids. Don't raise your voice. They raise their voice. Raise your tone this way, louder, louder. You're way up here. Now you have everybody in the bus come down. That doesn't serve a purpose. So it's hard not to. And this kind of stuff, our body language is 70% of our communication. So if we do a heavy sigh, or let's say somebody's getting, I presume the professionals help the students get the viruses?
No, our monitors.
Okay. So let's say the monitor is helping the student, the student's ringing the bus or whatever, and I'm the bus monitor. You know, when I hear when all it's coming out of me, he's getting it. He knows. I'm pretty frustrated. So we need to be in check of what we're doing and what we're saying and how we're sounding, because these are the things that the kids read well. My son has an intellectual disability. He is sharp on body language. He knows I'm not met. I'm done that. I'm exasperated. You know, that kind of thing. And he's so sharp that way. So even though they might have cognitive disabilities, I used to work at a county home in Iowa, and the bus driver there said, and this was way back when I was in college in the 80s, so let's take it back. He said, and our county home is for adults who are, you know, as we said, they're retarded. He said, they might be retarded, but they're not dumb. And that's the truth. They are not. They are pretty darn clever and sharp. Okay. You can't make me. You can't make me sit down. You're right. I can't make you. But I hope you choose a good choice that keeps you safe and keeps our bus safe. And you'll have your procedure. You probably can't drive with someone standing. Okay. All right. This kind of stuff doesn't work. Why don't it? Because I said so. Darn it, I said so. It's my bus. I can do what I want. You need to sit down. I'm going to write you up. Is that kid going to start doing this with you? You betcha. So we need to find out how are we sounding. And the bus monitor, as a team, together, you need to step in for each other. Because when our limbic system takes over, we're kaput. We're there. We need to be that team player and assist each other so that we can put it back in check, because that kid's reading us like a clock. They got us figured out. They know how to push that button. And it's hard not to get to that place because we don't have control over some of that sometimes. But when our voice goes shrill, when I used to teach in the classroom, the principal offered my classroom was like one way and we got together. He said, I can hear you when things are getting riled up in your room. Your voice goes really shrill and you're talking even faster. So, and that was in the 80s. We're teaching in 1986. That was one of those things that never left me. I've always learned that when I used to get angry or in conflict, everything goes to the foot. I don't have that control, so I have to practice that all the time. Okay. Techniques that help, just don't tolerate it. Defer back to your PBIS bus rules. When you've got something that holds everybody accountable to the same standards, you've got the power. And the consequence, you don't deliver the goods if it hasn't been earned or they haven't followed the rules. Okay, we talked about voice control. Threatening consequences, our kids that are struggling, consequences, that limbic system is in flight, consequence has to come later. At the end of the ride, maybe it's time to stop it tomorrow. When you come on, I'd like to do X, Y, and Z. They're back in control, you've done some deep breathing, you're all good, it's all calm. Have a great day, Latrice, I'm so glad you're on the bus today. You know? Okay. All right. Non-compliance. Which battles do you fight? I like to think about if it's not hurting someone, not hurting, if it's not, it doesn't make a difference, what difference does it make? Can a kid be yelling and fussing and carrying on? Nothing else is going on? Will you just tune it out? Are they hurting somebody? Were they disrespectful? Did they call you some bad names? Did they call a peer a bad name? I don't know what your rules in the bus are, but I would say some of us have just let go. Safety is the first concern. Verbal attack, if it escalates into physical, that's different. But verbal stuff is verbal stuff. And if we stop talking, the argument stops. So don't, you know, keep at it if it's going that direction. How do you handle broken rules? I would imagine there's certain things that are automatic write-ups. I don't know. Jason?
Yeah, and with special needs, a lot of the write-ups are for your information so that their caseworker will be aware
okay.
of situations.
Okay.
It's not necessarily disciplinary.
Yeah, things like the big buses where there's certain things that are just not tolerated and everybody is, you know, referred. Yeah, your special needs bus loads, of course, you're going to have individual circumstances. Okay. The flip side of your power struggle says variables that affect compliance. This one, there's a lot in there. It was kind of written for parents, so kind of, you know, think about it in your role. But the fourth one, not the fifth one down, one, two, three, five. Give the child time. Do you see that one? Give the child time on the variables that affect compliance. In school, in the classroom, we call this wait time. When we ask the student here's time to do something, let's not repeat ourselves until we've given them wait time to process, to think about, and with our power control kids, they'll do it when they're gonna do it. We'll let them do it when they're gonna do it. On the other hand, you will give a second prompt or a request and repeat it after you've given them that period of time to think about, process, you know, and do it. If they don't do anything and they need to do something, you can give a second request, same language, you decide what needs to be said. A new period of wait time starts before you expect the kid to reply or respond. After the second attempt and two wait periods is when you draw that line for the lower limit. That's when the consequent is in place. And that'll be individualized. So when you're working with kids who are having real compliance issues, you give the appropriate correction, the appropriate request, what they should be doing. Wait time, no response, and wait time. You know what? Wait time is forever. I'm going to say this for 5 seconds. It gets pretty awkward in a conversation. Somebody stops talking. That was 5 seconds. Some people say kids need 10 seconds or 20 seconds. If you truly use wait time, you need to be conscious of what that time period looks like, and all kids will be different. Some kids need a lot more before you give a second request. If you give it too soon, your kids are going to think you're in for an argument. So don't give it too soon because do not nay. Don't nay. In our lives as bus drivers, commanders, or bus bonders, teachers, parents, whatever we might be, we have human nature to want kids to succeed, and that's a good thing. But what we oftentimes do is to succeed so badly, that we give prompts 7 or 8 times. Then it becomes nagging to these kids that are non-compliant. And when we take a look at non-compliance, we can look at, are they non-compliant because they truly are willful and will not comply, or they really don't understand. They're being non-compliant because they don't understand. We have to give that some consideration also. Oh, of course, they understand. They're on my bus all year long. But really, have we broken it down? Have we really explained them and really shown them? And we use another student to model what that looks like. And that's powerful because those kids aren't always so good. At that moment when the wrong kid is being the right kid, boom, pull that kid in. Those are the kinds of things that are non-compliant kids. When you have to give choices, these are compliance. These are some of the things that they need to give. And when you give choices, you have to give a win-win. If, let's say, give me an example of something on your bus that you need to give a kid a choice. And they both have to be the right hands to yourself, or no kicking, or what can we do? What can we use? How can we troubleshoot that? Can we use kicking?
Wondering why.
Is, you said? Yeah, well, let's say there's a behavior that you want to stop, and you want to give them a choice so that stopping kicking or stopping where the behavior is indeed stops, but giving them a choice that they make that actually stops behavior.
Like standing up.
Okay, like standing up, okay. So if they're standing up on the bus, their choice are to sit down, right? Okay, so one choice is in the office couple, it's a very obvious one. One choice is, I'm gonna use a new person. What's your name?
Sharon.
Mm-hmm. All right, that's my formal name. Sharon, oh. I'll say, okay, Sharon. Sharon, you're standing. Our bus rules say no standing. Please sit. Or I will ask, what's your name?
Celeste
to help you. You want to sit by yourself? I'd like Celeste to help you sit.
I like Celeste.
All right. Celeste, sit. The win-win is she's going to sit. Are you going to do it by herself or with assistance? And she might not like Celeste.
Yeah.
So she'll sit.
I might not want me either.
Well, a choice the kid can make. And when those kids get to pick how that will be, just put those away. They've done it. You're okay. You're good to go. But then when they've done it, what's your next step?
Thank you.
Reinforce it. Sharon, I'm so glad you chose to sit down by yourself. You're such a growing person. Why are you mature? You know, whatever right language is right for those kids. Not only the high school language, but you know, let's say you're a four-year-old. You are growing up, Sharon. I'm so proud of you. Okay?
Right.
What you do after behavior is the likelihood that it will happen again. So you want to reinforce it. And with our younger kids, especially with our kids that have cognitive disabilities, you have to name what that was. Sharon, thank you for sitting down. Okay? Those are the kinds of things that we're talking about. Okay, questions so far? I think I said choice again. I'm trying to compliance again, though. Guidelines for discipline. Again, the don't nitpick, that kind of is my, doesn't make a difference. What difference does it make? Let's keep things in perspective. You know, you've heard of somebody getting sick and they say they pull out the big guns for the antibiotics, the ones that are pretty darn nasty. All right, let's pick up what fights we have to have. Pick your poison. But on the other hand of that is, let's not go to every battle. It's not important. Don't nitpick at stuff that doesn't matter. If Jerry's all out of control, but
if Gary's
fine and Sharon's fine and Kathy's fine, well, let Jerry have his bad moment. You know, are you okay with that? Am I standing here saying that? It's a different way to look at behavior. If everybody else is unriled by it, let it be. Why stimulate your emotions? When you draw attention to it, Jerry's going to know you're talking and you're going and whatever. But if it doesn't matter, it doesn't matter. If it's unsafe, that's another story. Okay. Don't be drawn into an argument. That was our power of strategies and how to stop it. Don't threaten something you can't do. And we lose credibility when we say, don't you ever do that on my bus again. Ever? I never want to see that happen. Never. Push back. Don't you ever try it again? Did your parents ever say to you, like, don't ever do this? And like that, you did it again. They might not have known about it, but you probably did it again. So those are kind of the things to be careful of. Drawing a line, don't threaten something that you can't follow through on. Don't discipline the whole group. Now, we talk about relationship building and making community. And the whole group might get, not discipline, might not get the reward. That's not discipline. That is rewarding positive behavior. All right? If, let's say, and you're not going to have radios, but I'm going to use this as an example anyway. Let's say the radio's on and somebody does something and you say, okay, radio's off. Well, should everybody have the radio off? There's only one person causing a problem. Filter that stuff out. Make sure that the punishment fits the crime, if you will. Handle negative comments away from other students. That's kind of hard to do probably because you're sitting in the driver's seat. But maybe you can have that conversation with the parent as they get off the bus. A private conversation. Confidentiality will always be safety and confidentiality are our two big components when we're working with children. Whatever on the playground, the cafeteria, the classroom, on the bus, whatever that might be. So we need to be careful of what we're talking about and who we're talking about with. And of course, call the situation out of hand. If you're struggling, don't be afraid to say, I need some help. Go to Jason and call up Wendy and say, I'm really struggling. I'm trying all the things, every single one of that sheet I've tried, but nothing's working for me. You know what? That's good. You need to ask for support. And maybe there's some dynamics that need to be looked at. It's okay to ask for that support from the administration or supervisor. It is okay to do that because some things are just out of our span, our realm. We really don't have the skills to do something. So don't really get too far before you're at the point of, I'm quitting, can't take this job, not doing it anymore. You don't get there. Try some things in between to get it figured out and resolved. Here's a big one, only get one direction at a time. Kids process slowly. 7 words or less is about the max that we can use in a request. Kids don't process a whole lot more words at the same time. We want to chunk what we need. Please sit down. Put your backpack under your seat. Make some pauses in between those kinds of things. One direction at a time. Start wait time again. Allow time for the student to comply. And if you say, I'm going to give you 10 seconds. Uh-oh, that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about, Jerry, you didn't have to get all the
situation. Sherry, please put your backpack under your seat. And then I'm going to count in my way whether I tap my leg with my fingers and I count out 10 or whatever it's going to be. And I'm going to say, Jerry, please put your backpack away. Maybe 10 seconds. That's what we're talking about. You're not going to count in front of the kid because that's setting them up. That's what you're going to do in college training. And this is not a problem for you because you're usually 3 feet from the first, I would think, once they're seated in the place. Be consistent with each child. If you follow those PBIS rules or you have something you can work from, if you have your own bus rules. I think you can do that, yes?
Yes.
Which driver and team monitor or bus monitor can make your rules up. And that's perfect, and it's even better when the kids help make them up. Because when the kids help make them up, there's ownership and buy-in. But there has to be some reinforcement, there has to be some payoff for following those rules, especially if you have an unruly group. You have to have something there that's powerful enough to make them want to work hard to stay within the lines of what the rules are. Plan to ignore it. This is a term we use in special education. Let's say, and you guys have been awesome, let me tell you that.
There's not been a check on them. We should have a conference or a workshop to get a check.
You say teachers are the worst for an audience. I would go on record and say bus drivers are the best audience. Right on. You are. We're really amazing. So let's say, for instance, the scales chit chat and Carl. What's your first name?
Christina.
Okay, Christina and Carl are talking. But first, we do a different, not kind of different. This strategy I'm showing you right now is called proximity control. Okay, so this is what your monitor is. You're the bus driver, you can't get up. Monitor, these two are screwing around the bus. I'm going to go over here and just stand. Now, the monitor can get up, yes?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. All right, so I'm just going to stand. And because you're adolescent, you sure as heck don't want me here. So the behavior generally stops when the person comes near or stands by. So let's say she's on herself and she's not. But let's say she is, and I come back here and stand. I'm using some proximity to manage the behavior. I don't say anything. Plan to ignoring is I'm going to use a cell phone to pretend we're in a classroom. Let's say the rule is not to have cell phones out. Let's say, this scale up here, who had cousins. Tanya? All right. Let's say Tanya's got her cell phone out, and the classroom rule is about no cell phones. And I see that, what's your name?
Robert.
All right. She's got her cell phone out, Robert does not. Why I'm ignoring is, Robert, thank you for keeping your belongings where they are. I love that you have your phone in your backpack. You're not using your phone. I'm reinforcing Robert, and over here I didn't have to call her out and say, Tanya, I didn't have time to please put your phone away. Instead, I praise the appropriate behavior and notice what's going on instead. That way, if my reinforcement matters, she will put her phone away. Or whatever your situation the bus is. Okay? That's a classroom example. I don't know if your kids have phones on buses or not. You understand what proximity control is, and it's already looked like plenty. But recognize the appropriate behavior by somebody else. So let's say Robert didn't have his phone out, and I say, Robert, thanks for keeping your belongings in your backpack. I appreciate that on my bus. We do so well with things together. And then Tanya puts hers away. I need it in my rear view notice. Tanya, thanks for putting your phone away. That's awesome. And move on. I need to let Tanya know that I noticed she followed the rule without my having to say you broke it. So plan ignoring is a powerful thing, and you only got to. What's the max on your buses?
4, 5, 6.
I don't know. What size are they?
There's no max.
Of number of students on a bus?
Yeah.
I mean, are they all have capacity?
Oh.
Are your buses a capacity of 20?
I would say probably you're not going to see more than 10 kids.
Okay, so you could have that many. So plan ignoring could work. I wonder if you have 3 or 4 kids. If you have 10 kids, that's a strategy that can work well because you've got enough kids probably doing the right thing. So a strategy there for you. Again, our neutral tone of voice, when our voice starts to rise, when we become shrill, when we talk more quickly or whatever it is, keep it neutral as best you can. Be aware of that. Back to the team thing, the bus monitor, the bus driver, be aware of each other. And it's okay to support each other and say, she's giving me a nod, so I'm going to go with you. What's your name?
Felicia.
Let's say, are you partners? Okay. Let's say they are. Felicia and Patrice are partners. Driver, monitor, that's what's going on. But let's say they are, and let's say Latrice is recognizing she's about her max. You need to give her a signal. That's right. You know, because we get there. We don't want to get there, but we do. You need to work as a team and recognize what happens in each other when they get to that point. Because sometimes we can't bring it back down. If that cortisol's flooding, it's going somewhere. We gotta put it back. Somebody needs to take over for you. You're the mom and the pop on the bus. All right, let's say you have to discipline a kid. You have to, for safety reasons, you have to, you know, reinstate your role. You have to have a conference. That's all good and well. I'm not saying we can never do that. There are times we're going to have to do that. But there's some research out there. You know what? It varies from 4 to 6 to 8 to 10. Who knows what? What I like to use is 6 to 1. For every one time you have to, can I use the word scold? Every one time you have to scold a student or discuss with a student a situation that wasn't appropriate, you need to come back with 6 positive comments to move away from that one. You want to keep building that person up, so keep 6 to 1 in your mind. We are going to have times that we have to be clear with the kids. We have to have consequences. I'm not saying we never do, we will. But let's come back with a conscious reminder of 6 times. And if that means masking tape on your leg with a marker and you mark it down with hash marks, please do. If you want to pick 4 for that kid, pick 4. If you want to pick 5, pick 5. No less than 4. You have to find 4 opportunities that kid is doing the right thing. You're reestablishing relationship, you're identifying what's good going on, and the kid will know that you're facing the right things going on, and hopefully the behavior subsides or at least goes down.
Question.
Yes.
When you're doing that, how important is sincerity?
Huge.
I would think so. I know it is with somebody without special needs, but I didn't know.
Did you get the question? How important is sincerity when you're doing that 6 to 1? It's huge because it's meaningless if it's not sincere. You know, doesn't it feel good when somebody says, that is an awesome jacket. That color just strikes, it's perfect on you. I can say, great looking jacket. Really? You know, the sincerity has to come through. And with behavior reinforcement, your reinforcement, your comments, your praise has to be immediate, sincere, and specific. So that neon jacket is beautiful on you. It's a great compliment to your hair color. Hope that I'm looking at her, and I've got a smile going, and my voice sounds like I mean it. Some of you can't find much to praise, but find something. Find the shoelaces on the kid's shoe.
Just to piggyback on her, this is how my kids are learning. Sometimes they don't understand what you're saying. But what if you really have a problem with communicating and liking that behavior on the child? How are you going to?
So I was saying the kid doesn't have verbal expression.
I was going to pick up on that. It's essentially to keep that cute in the mind. Don't make it personal, right? Okay. And Sherry, you've done a great job of giving us the reasons. I've been a special ed teacher prior to this role for many years. And I had to keep in the back of my head this piece that you mentioned about the ACEs and what a student is coming to the table. You mentioned, how would I know? But just know, there's some reason. Kids don't wake up in the morning and say, I'm going to make that bus driver's life miserable. Okay? There's some reason. So as the adult in this situation, that's when you pull that up, and as all the mamas and daddies and uncles and aunts that you might be, or brothers or sisters, you bring that up, and you go, I love that. It reminds me of that one. The story, you heard the backstory, the story, you know, like, you come up with something. I don't know what you're saying. I have been in a situation where I'm thinking, okay, you're telling me I got to find something positive? I'm struggling right now. You find it. It's something to do with their personal, how they look, because you're struggling with that personality piece. Find something.
So defer back to what they could turn into a question. You were having a spelling test. How did that go? You know, find something that kind of goes back to what is a good spot for them or a good place. I thought maybe at the nonverbal piece. You want to maybe learn some basic sign language so that you can use some of that together, or a picture card, and then those communication concerns also. So. That go? Okay. We're almost finished. It's almost 11 o'clock, too. Okay. We've done this one, the PBIS stuff. stay clear and simply, and I think it's helpful to have the rules on the bus, we have every classroom, we have our PBS mom in the building, but you might have your own list of rules, and put some pictures with that, ask Wendy to help you with that, she's got the tools to make those kind of lists for you. Oops. And make sure the student understands what the behavior expectation is. The last thing I want to go to is this default button. When we have problems on our bus, whether they be social emotional impaired, physical issues, or whatever, when there's something going on your bus that's upsetting or disruptive or unsafe, we automatically default to how we were raised as kids. We discipline how we were disciplined or what we know. That might have been leniency, it might be strictness, it might be no tolerance. We need to know that our kids all are different and come from different places. So we default to what we know. My mom was a yeller. I got a blanket one time and all these things, and how a parent once said, stop yelling. It was in red. I put it at my wall on eye level because I'm like, yeah. I didn't just see that. I was a yeller, you know, and my mom was a yeller. But we do things because that's what we have heard, that's what we've known. We have to rise up and find out what the school modification programs are, what the kids are on behavior reinforcement, et cetera, et cetera. We will discipline the way we've been disciplined. We will react the way we've been reacted to. So we need to, that's go back to that empathy thing. Let's understand their circumstances are different than ours. The way I know it is different. I have more behavior trainings, I don't know, but some of that stuff is what comes into play with how we respond to kids when they have a lot of issues. It's okay to say when the kids get to you, I am upset right now, but you're going to say it in a voice that's in control. You know, not, I'm so mad right now at you. You know, of course you are. What does that set them up? You need to bring it down again to the level that you can say, yes, I'm upset right now. But you know what? You make our bus great, and we're going to deal with this in another way or talk tomorrow or something. You like that one for a while? So these are the things we want to be sensitive to, our tone, our volume, how close do we get, even home monitor, bus monitors, don't get in the kid's face, because kids are already mad. She's got her hands right here. Boy, I'm going to get popped, I'm going to get slapped, I'm going to get hair pulled, whatever. Be sensitive. Treat them with respect and dignity. 3 feet is your good arms, is your tool. So you're not too close, don't get in their space too close. And here's, this is nonverbal language, right? You know what she's feeling, you can see it. So how we sound and how we look supports what's actually happening. So those are the kinds of things that we need to go to that default place, how we look, how we sound. All right, questions, 11 o'clock, comments?
We have a child, well, he's more like high school age. Yeah, I'm not sure if it is pre-notification or is
you can all feel free to go if you
want. I want to thank you very much.
Thank you.